I believe it's possible to fly as a bird. And here I am. You can look this device over. It appears heavy. It's light.
From the KHJ studios in Hollywood, it's John Barber's Live Friday Night Talk Show. Tonight looks like Zap the Establishment Night when John talks to the original Zappa, musician Frank Zappa. Attorney Wendell Fail talks about the legal establishment. UFO expert William Moore takes on the military and scientific establishment. And the editor of Realist, humorist Paul Krasner, takes on the political establishment. And John takes us to a food establishment in Oregon that is proud that what they serve is the worst. And now here's our host who tries to serve you the best, Mr. Establishment himself, John Barber.
Good evening and welcome to KHJ, which for the next hour might stand for Kidding, Hitting, and Jousting. Tonight we're going to try to do something new on the show, entertain you. Actually, what we're doing is sort of a happy accident tonight. And I've always had the feeling that the best things that happen to us in life happen by accident, whereas all the bad things, if you ever notice, they're always really well planned. Like the Vietnam War was well planned, the Joan Rivers show was well planned, the Watergate break-in was well planned, the Iran-Contra arms deal was well planned, but it was only an accident that the Iran-Contra arms deal was broken when there was a little article appeared in a paper in the Middle East. It was only an accident that they caught that the black guard sort of found the open door at the Watergate Hotel. Bill Cosby's show was an accident. It was turned down by ABC. All in the Family was an accident at CBS. It was turned down twice by ABC. ABC could stand for anything but creative. My son was an accident. That's not true. That was well planned. But tonight's show sort of will turn out, I think, to be one of those happy accidents. So if tonight's show is entertaining and interesting, that will be an accident. And if it's not, it's because we well planned it about 2 minutes before showtime. I have an enormous affection for what some people in the establishment might term misfits. And tonight's show inadvertently turned out to be a collection of some of the brightest misfits that we know of. And as I say, it didn't start out that way, but then we thought, you know, what we have done frequently, because the show is live and a lot of the guests really are interesting, is frequently get to the end of the show and we run out of time. Well, I didn't want to run out of time anymore tonight, and we were sitting around looking at and talking to these four terrific guests, and we thought, hey, hold it a second. Remember Irv Kupcinet's show out of Chicago? I think it was called At Random. And what Irv used to do, he'd get four or five people from disparate backgrounds, put them on stage, and just let them talk. And it was just a fabulous show. And we thought, you know, I don't want to waste any time tonight. And there's so many interesting people here who have so much to say. So we decided that we were going to tear a little sheet out of Cup's column and do the show a little bit the way Irv Kupcinet did. And that's what we're going to do, and you're going to be able to participate in this conversation, because, as you know, you can call in, because we are live. And our guests tonight are Frank Zappa, who's an innovative musician, as you know, and iconoclast, who gained international fame as the founder of the rock group Mothers of Invention, and who has referred to some of the political establishment as the Mothers of Prevention. Paul Krasner, who just returned from an international humor convention, which included the Russians, is recognized as one of the most literate and entertaining counterculture humorists in America. As editor of The Realist and contributing editor to The National Lampoon, Paul has been referred to as a cross between Lenny Bruce and an underground Will Rogers. William Moore is one of the most widely known and respected experts researching UFOs, which were extensively in the news again this past week, as you know. And Mr. Moore says that if the CIA is covering up covert operations, the Air Force and military are doing the same with UFOs. Wendell Fail, aside from having our viewers vote him the sincerest attorney in Los Angeles a few weeks ago, has been applauded by his peers as one of the most insightful and amusing critics of the legal status quo. And when we come back, you and I are going to be talking to him. We'll be right back.
Sereno Suzuki is one of
Welcome back to the show. The first question that I want to ask you, Frank.
That was an accident. Do we have a misfit for a host too?
Because everybody asked me as soon as they heard Frank was going to be on the show, ask him why he wasn't on the Joan Rivers show. I said, I don't want, because he'll put down the Joan Rivers show. They said, I don't care, ask him.
I won't really put down the Joan Rivers show. I don't think that is possible. I don't think it's necessary. The decision to not put me on the show was a middle management decision based on sheer terror, and that's that.
Yes, but the point is that you would have thought at an independent network like Fox wanting to do a different kind of a show, and since they were doing substitute hosts, and since they do spend a lot of their time doing musicians, that you would have been a perfect host for at least one night.
That's based on an erroneous assumption that they want to do something different. They don't want to do something different. You may want to do something different, but they don't want to do anything different, and I don't think anybody else wants to do anything different either.
Then why did they book you in the first place?
I think it was probably a clerical error.
Paul, have you ever been invited to be on the Joan Rivers show or any other establishment?
I'm going to be on a week from tonight.
Are you really? With whom?
I don't know.
as a host or as
no,
a guest?
No, as a guest.
And they don't know who's hosting the show
well,
yet?
Well, they may know, but I didn't ask.
Oh, that's terrific. Good for you.
But I've been on a lot of the other shows. I was on the Johnny Carson show, but Orson Bean was the guest host. So it was a personal invitation.
How long ago was that?
That was about 20 years ago. 18, it was 1969 on Valentine's Day.
You just got back from an international humor convention.
In Phoenix, of all places.
And the Russians had representatives there?
Yeah, there were representatives of 35 countries. And there's an international humor movement. And this was a conference where they analyze humor very seriously. You know, like, what is the significance of laughter in the yellow-naped parrot? Something we were just wondering about the other day.
But why, doesn't that really kill humor when you try to analyze it?
Well, that's why it was fun for me there, to see them analyze what I do instinctively. And, but I guess if they enjoy it, you know, I mean, it's better they do that than make weapons, so I have no complaints about them.
Of course they do both, though.
Oh, I suppose, right? Make weapons with a sense of humor.
All right.
Well, did you see much evidence from the Russians that they had a sense of humor that was sort of as anti-establishment in their way as yours is in
well,
your way?
Well, I mean, I published The Realist, which is totally independent. I met the editor of Krokodil, which is the Russian satirical magazine, but it's published by the state, and so by the government. So, there is an automatic... you know, they'll joke about absenteeism and productivity, you know, and so as one underground journalist told me that their humor is for the state rather than for the people. But when you met them on a one-to-one basis, they were very charming, and we had one event at UCLA where they were going to show some caricatures on a screen, and for one moment the screen was lit and there were no images on it, and I started going like this on the screen. And one of the Russians started making other things, and it was a great moment of nonverbal communication.
One of the most terrific cartoons I've ever seen outside of some of Paul Conrad's work was in Krokodil in the middle 70s. And it was a Russian teacher asking a student, Yorgi or whoever it was, if he knew the difference between capitalism and communism. And Yorgi said yes. Under capitalism, man exploits man. But under communism, it's the other way around. I thought, gee, if that really appeared in a Russian magazine, that was terrific. Was the Iran-Contra hearings on everybody's mind down there?
It was just getting underway. In fact, they asked me to tell a joke that would make the Russians laugh, and I try to take what I try to take something that would be a good example of freedom of expression. So I told this story about how. They discovered when they did an autopsy of William Casey of the CIA, they discovered that in the brain operation, only the section was removed from August 1985 to November 1986. And the Americans and the Russians both laughed at that one.
Because they could remember that Nixon had erased 18 and a half minutes of, or somebody had erased
or
18
that,
and a half
or
minutes
that,
of tape.
Or that Casey had erased 18 months from his memory.
Frank, were you watching the Iran-Contra hearings? Were all you fellows watching?
It was my life.
Huh?
It was my life.
What were you getting from those hearings as you watched them?
Well, it's what I wasn't getting from the hearing that upset me the most, because it seems that the biggest thing that they left out was the link between fundamentalist television evangelists and the funding for the Contras. There is a direct link between Pat Robertson and Oliver North. As a matter of fact, on the last day of North's testimony, when they were talking about his slideshow, ABC News ran a piece of tape, which they said was exclusive to them, that was Ollie North in action giving his slideshow. And it was being done at the White House and was for a whole room full of evangelists. So you know that the appeal has gone directly to these guys. Pat Robertson refers to Oliver North as my friend Ollie North.
Mm-hmm.
He shows a videotape of himself reviewing Contra troops, and I presume that the average guy in the street, if he wanted to have his picture taken with Contra troops, he would have to know somebody and maybe give a couple of bucks in order to get the Contras to sort of stand still and stand at attention when you show up with a video crew and a khaki jacket on.
Wendell, as an attorney, what were your impressions?
Well, I think, John, it's really interesting. We're revisiting the 60s and other periods and how this thing has come full circle.
In what way?
Well, in the 60s, we had the clergy of the left supporting the left, and that was wonderful. No one saw any harm of that. Now we have the fundamentalists who support the rightist position, the Contras, and suddenly this is a great panic. Also, Ollie North, Fawn Hall, these people are really a rerun of the 60s.
In what way?
Well, in the 60s, we had people telling us you can disobey the law, you can burn your draft card, pour blood, do police cars, leak government secrets, break into doctors' offices, and as long as it's for a higher purpose, there's nothing wrong with that. You can lie or whatever. Now we have rightist people, Ollie North, Fawn Hall, and company, who are telling us, yes, they lied, yes, they broke the law, but they did it for a higher purpose. So in my lifetime, I've got to see this thing come full circle, and I think it's quite interesting.
Except that when we committed civil disobedience, it was at the risk of going to prison for it, and these guys are fighting pretty hard not to do that.
Well, I don't think that the special prosecutor is going to let up any more than some of the ones did in the past, except that the American public, for the first time, Paul, has gotten to hear what the position of a United States is in Nicaragua, and to hear the testimony and learn the truth, and the public outpouring has been tremendous.
Well, learn the truth. Are you serious?
Right now, we're going to learn the truth about some commercials, and we're very serious about that. Yeah, we'll be right back.
There's going to be accidents.
Yeah. Did you guys? Welcome back. Our guests are attorney Wendell Fail, satirist Paul Krasner, UFO expert and researcher William Moore, and musician Frank Zappa. Bill, as somebody who's suspicious of the military establishment because you claim that they're keeping secrets from us about the existence of UFOs, did you watch the Iran-Contra hearings with any other kinds of insights?
I watched some of them, John. I didn't watch all of them. I was on the road most of the time that was going on, so I'd catch pieces here and there. I guess the thing that impressed me more than anything else was to watch all of these people literally falling all over each other trying to say, mea culpa, it's me, I'm the guilty one. And watching the politicians on the other side, the prosecutor and his cohorts, trying to be the bad guys and failing miserably at it. Because here we are with the witnesses turning out to be the heroes of the show.
Mm-hmm.
And that's virtually unheard of, unthinkable. Going back to a thing that was mentioned a little earlier in the show with the erasing of the tapes in the Watergate affair, one of the funny little sidelines that's come up in the course of researching, of all things UFOs, and going through documents and presidential libraries and archives and so on, is the number of times that Rose Wood has come up just on pieces of paper. This lady has had a career going all the way back to, I guess, the Truman administration. And it was rather fascinating to see.
Remember that picture of her, though, that they ran where that showed the pose that she supposedly had to be in to accidentally erase the tapes where she's kind
Yes, I do.
Yeah, I remember Rosewood. Yeah.
During the break, because Wendell brought up the business of Nicaragua and the fact that the left today is a little shocked because the right clergy is now doing what the left clergy was doing then. And Paul pointed out that when those people who were engaged in civil disobedience, like Martin Luther King, went out there to break a law, they went out there to change the law. You don't find the Ollie Norris or the rest of them going out there to change any laws. What it is that they're doing, they're looking for amnesty and pardons before they even proceed.
Well, John, I think anybody would have to recognize that in this country, the movements that you just mentioned, now Martin Luther King, of course, was demonstrating for freedom of a people from racial oppression, which is a little bit different, in my opinion, from the other problems that we had in the 1960s politically. And we don't have the media, those people who are for freedom in Nicaragua, to keep the Marxists off our continent. We don't have the media. The Los Angeles Times has been almost apoplectic in their editorials over the fact that the Americans, once they had a chance to hear the position that people like Ollie North have, are heroes. This committee went out to get Reagan. They went out to find a smoking gun. They thought they would be heroes, and I predicted at the beginning of these hearings that we would find out more about the people who were on the committee than we would who the people that came to testify, and that's exactly what's happened, and the American people didn't like the people on the committee.
Did you happen to see, I asked this during the break, Nightline the other night, when they were talking about the shooting of the movie Walker. Universal is in Nicaragua, working with the Sandinistas, shooting a movie about a fellow named Walker, who is an American who in the middle 1900s literally invaded Nicaragua with a handful of people and set himself up as prime minister. And in the 1920s, the United States sent Marines in there. So if the Nicaraguans are a little reluctant to deal with the Americans because they don't like them constantly intruding, don't you think that's justified?
Well, John, I think that America has had a history of intervention in South America and Latin America. However, what we're faced with today is a totalitarian Marxist government. The people who support the Sandinistas say they believe them, and I don't understand why they don't believe them when they say what their intentions are, which is to turn Nicaragua into a Marxist state, you know, like Cuba, where you get one shirt a year, or Bulgaria.
Well, you know, my son asked me, he said, Dad, if we're sending money down there to the Contras, we're really hiring people to go in there. I mean, the Contras aren't in there on their own. They're hired by the CIA to go in there. If we want to do that in Nicaragua, he said, why don't we send troops into China? How come the Chinese are the good communists and the Nicaraguans are the bad communists? Now, I didn't have an answer for him. Do you have an answer?
Oh, sure. The Chinese, as they presently exist, which are becoming more and more a capitalist economy every day, they found of necessity that Marxism is a hoax. And they're going to, they've brought back the bazaars, they've brought back the free market system in agriculture and food production. What we have is on our continent, people who have decided that they want to export their revolution. They have the largest standing army, you have to have a ration card, you have to attend meetings, there's press censorship. It's a typical consolidation. I remember all this being replayed in Cuba, John, don't you? When Fidel Castro was an agrarian land reformer and there were going to be private business and freedom and all this sort of thing. It's simply a move to consolidate the power.
Well, do all of you remember when Fidel Castro was a hero in this country, came to New York, was on the Jack Parr show?
Was a hero of the left.
Well, he was a hero in this country. You know, this is an obscure piece of information that I just threw out for whatever it's worth, that Fidel Castro, prior to the time that he nationalized the American oil refineries in Havana, was never an avowed Marxist. He never said he was a Marxist. He said he was an agrarian land reformer who wanted to have a revolution. Now, in Cuba, you could not grow a potato unless you got permission from the King brothers in Texas, who owned half of Cuba, right? So when they took over, oil was being offered to the Cubans. The Russians were selling it at something like $8 a barrel, and the Americans were selling it at $23 a barrel. Well, their good businessmen, so you got to buy the $8 a barrel oil. So they bought the Russian oil. And the Americans said, you can't refine it in our refineries. So at that point, Castor was still a hero. He was on the cover of Life magazine. He was eating chicken in Harlem. Mm-hmm. He was on the Jack Parr show, and he said, hold it. If I'm going to have a revolution, I got to have a revolution. I need to refine the oil. So what he did is he took over the oil refineries, and he paid back the Americans the value of the refineries as they declared the refineries on their income tax returns. And only then did Americans call them communists. And maybe that the Chinese are good communists, because now the Chinese buy Pepsi-Cola. Now the Chinese are consumers.
No, I assume the Russians would qualify as good communists then, because don't they buy Pepsi-Cola?
They buy Pepsi-Cola.
And didn't Nixon set that up?
Nixon set up Pepsi when he was an attorney for them.
Yeah, because that's how we managed to get Russian vodka. That was the swap.
Right. Right. So,
so they're good
in
communists.
In El Salvador, the Kimberly-Clark Company has its plant where they make Kleenex. And it was Kleenex that sponsored the Lou Grant show, which fired Ed Asner because of his outspoken statements on it. So, you know, it's a little bit more than these Marxists that you talk about. It's American businessmen.
It's very complex because, first of all, the Sandinistas were not the only people in the revolution. It was a broad-based, with business people, all sorts of support. But they have done typically what Marxists do. They participate in a broad-based revolution, then claim the credit, and slowly close out the other factions, put them in jail, kill them, exile them.
Okay, let's change the subject a little bit from politics and get to the business of television, which Paul just brought up. And we'll get to more of that after this business of television, which is commercials. We'll be right back after this. Welcome back. The question about television, which I throw out to all of you because Paul brought it up, and so I'll direct it to you first, and Paul, if you wish to answer. You brought up the fact that the Lou Grant show was canceled. It had pretty good ratings because Ed Asner came out publicly, said he was going to send some money for humanitarian purposes, Band-Aids or something, to the rebels in El Salvador. Show's canceled. Now along comes Stacy Keach, who is arrested for using coke. Now, it's not like he confesses and he gives himself up. Somebody rats on him at the airport in England. And he's sentenced to 6 months in prison. And he gets a television show.
But he repented. Ed Asner never repented.
How did Stacy repent?
He started saying that he was sorry that he ever took drugs. He started doing anti-drug public service announcements.
Yes, but he didn't do it voluntarily. It was all part of the Reformation program, right? But I mean, what does that tell us about our sense of values?
That it's very flexible.
It's called situational ethics. That's all. Yeah, it's plausible deniability carried to the extreme.
William, you claim that UFOs do exist?
Of course they exist.
Now, why do you say "of course" so emphatically?
Well, UFO, by definition, is any object in the air or on the ground that the observer cannot identify at the time. And there are literally hundreds of thousands of those cases on record. Some UFOs, not all.
Did you happen to see the news last week? They had a fellow on who had taken some videotape of some unidentified flying objects, and they run it frame by frame through whatever devices they run them through, and they could come to no other conclusion that they were UFOs?
Well, there are a number of films and tapes like that. One of the better known ones is the Kaikoura tape from New Zealand back in 1979, taken from an aircraft by a news crew. And that particular tape, in fact, I think we have a still from that tape later on in the show, slide of it.
Let's call for some of the slides out. Frank, do you believe in UFOs?
Yeah.
You do, really?
Mm-hmm.
Why?
I think that they're real.
Why?
If you had to choose between they're not real and they're real, what do you got in the middle? They're real.
Bill, that slide that we just had up, Melanie, could you put that one back up? Bill, what is that?
That was taken in Brazil in 1952.
But that's a hubcap.
It's a fisheye.
It's a series of slides, actually. I think there were four or five pictures in that sequence. The object has never been satisfactorily identified. This one taken actually... It showed up in a promotional photograph for a military aircraft. And in the process of developing the film, that thing showed up in the frame. No one saw it. It was just there on the film.
And, in your research, in this one here, what is this
one? This one is from McMinnville, Oregon. It's one of the better known photographs. There are two in this sequence, taken by a gentleman by the name of Paul Trent, all the way back in 1950. But important because fairly recently, an optical physicist for the working for the Navy, but not under a Navy contract to do it, working on his own time, did an analytical procedure on the original negatives and determined that based upon a variety of scientifically derived data, that the object could only be a large object tens of meters in diameter a good distance from the camera, completely ruled out a small object thrown up in the air.
Did you start out preconceived to believe that they did exist, or were you a doubter, or why did you get into
it? Well, I'm still a doubter. It's not a belief system, John. I think that's an erroneous statement. I believe that vanilla is better than chocolate, or that warm weather is better than cold. That's a belief. There are reams of data, reams of evidence, which would indicate a reality for UFOs as someone else's spacecraft.
Under the Freedom of Information Act, have you or your organization or any people that you know gathered documents that seem to indicate that the government is indeed suppressing information
Certainly,
about them?
Certainly, a great many documents from all the way back in 1946 all the way to the present day, and from an entire alphabet soup of government agencies. In fact, one of the most fascinating processes we've been through is a suit against the National Security Agency, or NSA, which some people believe means never says anything. It's one of the most secret groups in the country, with twice the personnel and twice the budget of the CIA, I might add. We went all the way to the Supreme Court in a conflict over the admission by NSA that they had at least 160 documents, not pages, documents, about UFOs, which they would release none of, not even the dates.
Wendell, do you believe they exist?
Well, I believe they exist to the same reason I believe the John Barbour show exists. Everybody tells me they've seen it. But
good, Wendell.
But the fact is, I think what Bill's getting at is it's something that should be investigated. And he mentioned the NSA. Until a few years ago, nobody even knew what they were. Their principal function is to listen to all radio traffic and examine the skies for any electronic signals all over this planet. I have a brother retired from 27 years in that occupation. Now, he hasn't told me anything, but I do know what their particular mission is. The ship, the Pueblo, was involved in that occupation.
Well, you remember the 007 incident when the Korean jetliner was shot down, and 2 days later, suddenly we were releasing taped recordings of the transmissions for the Russian ground control to the jet pilots that shot the plane down. Where did they come from? NSA.
Do you believe they exist, Paul?
I just don't know. You know, I mean, why don't they come visit me? You know, I'm
that's not the right question, though, Paul. The right question there is, why would they want to?
Well, what are they doing here? I would give them publicity, granola, whatever they want.
Good evening. Welcome to the show. You have a question or a comment?
I do. I'd like to ask Mr. Zappa if he would like to comment on what's going on with the warning labels for a rock album.
Well, very little is going on with it. A few record companies plopped a couple of stickers on some records in a, you know, kind of a lame gesture of compliance. And basically, most of the people who write rock and roll songs write lyrics that wouldn't offend anybody. And so there's literally no need for a warning sticker on a record. And that's one of the reasons why Tipper and the rest of the gang have shifted over to home video as a new cause to investigate.
Although the trial of Jello Biafra begins on August 11th.
What is that?
But that's not a record sticker case.
But it's the same ultimate censorship.
It comes from the same aroma, yeah.
Yeah, but right. What is the trial about?
Well, Jello Biafra is the lead singer for the Dead Kennedys, a punk rock group, and they had a poster in their album which was considered to be obscene, and that trial is beginning here.
I could vaguely understand somebody perhaps wanting some kind of labels on a record label, because that would be a little more public than a home video, wouldn't it?
Well, John, what the legal theory is here, that, for instance, while adults, for instance, in our state, can have pornographic material for their use, there's a different set of laws that pertain to minors. The legal theory is that society has a greater interest in protecting the materials that are available to minors, whether it be alcohol, pornography, or whatever else. And many of the rock music is aimed not at the over 21 or over 18 crowd, but at what they, at the bubblegum crowd, the 12, 13, 14 year olds. And to claim that the rock musicians and other people do not have influence in these young people's life, I think is patently ludicrous on its face.
Well, the question would appear to be, though, does rock music lead the youth of America into greater and greater depths of pornography, or in fact, does rock music simply reflect the status quo of society? And I think the latter is probably
more important. Or maybe it just simply entertains and diverts.
Or maybe is there a First Amendment along with the UFOs?
Yeah, it's a reflection of what's already there.
Or maybe there's no such thing as a dirty word. I maintain that there's no word or noise you can make with your mouth that is so powerful that you're going to go to hell because it comes out. I mean, the thing was about words in the whole record rating business, and nobody ever managed to prove that if I go boo on a record that somebody is going to lose their soul or lose their mind.
We're gonna take a break right now, and when we come back, perhaps you would like to talk to us. The number here is 1-800-222-6522. We'll be right back with your calls and comments. Welcome back. Let's take another call. Good evening. Welcome to the show. You have a question or comment?
Hello.
Hello.
Yes, I'd like to speak to the gentleman, the lawyer. You know, for years now, they're talking about communism in South America. What happened to the years of fascism? At that point, they didn't want to address it when we were raping those countries and those people were starving. Now it's communism. Those people don't care about the terminology. They care about feeding their families. And when we were down there for years, stealing them blind and not caring, but it was fascism and we were making money, it was okay. Now it's communism and it's terrible.
Well, I don't think it was okay personally. I think it's wrong and it's dead wrong. But I think that you're right, very much so, in one thing that you said. Whether it's fascism or communism doesn't make much difference to those people, because if you're an inmate in a concentration camp or a gulag, the symbol that the concentration camp guards have on their arm, whether it be a swastika or a hammer and sickle, is of very little importance to you. And I think that we deserve to help those countries, but to allow our archenemy in the modern world, the Soviet Union, to establish a beachhead within driving distance of Los Angeles, to me, I think, is a matter of very serious concern.
Let's take another call. Thanks for your comment. Yes, welcome to the show. You have a question or comment?
Yes, I have a question for Mr. Moore. I would like to ask him if he's aware of an organization called the Committee at Residence. It's supposed to be a joint government, technological, paramilitary conglomerate that is at this particular moment suppressing all UFO knowledge. And also I would like to ask you a question about biogenetic experimentation by aliens that are taking place in Brazil.
Wow.
I'm not familiar with the first one at all. That's the first I've ever heard of anything like that. In the second instance, the question of biogenetic experiments by aliens is addressed quite succinctly in a best-selling book that's right now on the market by Bud Hopkins, a book called Intruders. And I strongly recommend that book to the caller as a source of information there. There's also a book out by Whitley Strieber called Communion, which is a more personal thing. Whitley talking about personal experiences, Bud talking about researching 140 different cases, of which do seem to be biogenetic.
Bill, research. You say some of, I hate to use the word belief again, but I have to use that word to ask you the question. Do you believe, I mean, we know you believe in the UFOs, but do you believe that some people have actually been taken aboard these craft, and there have been experiments with them on these craft?
John, there are only two possibilities that I can see in those cases, and I've dealt with a number of those cases myself and looked at reports from others that have investigated them. And the two possibilities are that we are dealing either with reality. These things are happening. Aliens are coming here, snatching up our citizens and doing their thing and dumping them back out. Or we are witnessing a previously unnoticed or unseen form of psychosis, which is becoming more and more widespread. One or the other. In either case, we desperately need to do some more studying to determine what's going on. The evidence would seem to come down on the side of actual abductions, because there are cases where there are actual traces on the ground. There are sightings by other people in the area, having seen lights over houses and strange occurrences with the electrical systems and televisions going off and that sort of thing. That would seem to suggest a technology rather than a psychosis.
Let's take another call. Thanks for your call. Good evening. Welcome to the show. Your question or comment?
Yes, I was earlier when Frank Zappa was talking about the rock music, I was saying, why do so many rock musicians sing about negative stuff? Like, you know, there was one, the Beatles, they started backward masking, and they commented on it. They were, when they started off with the White Album, and that's when, Charles Manson went crazy. You know, I was just wondering if you guys have any comments on that.
Well, did you listen to the White Album?
Yes, I've listened to it many
times.
Did
you go crazy? How many people in the United States heard the White Album? I mean, the only guy that had an experience from it was Charles Manson.
But
he's
why
a,
do they
you know, unique guy.
Why do they sing about it in the first place?
I can't hear you. Say that again.
Why do they sing about negative things in the first place if they're going to cause so much trouble? Why cause so much trouble? Why don't they just sing about something else? Why do they always have to sing about to rebel and to do all, you know, they sing about negative stuff all the time. Why do they have to sing about that?
Well, you know, those naughty Beatles, you can never keep them under control. There was just no way to make them sing love songs all the time. And the White Album came along. Is that the one that had Maxwell's Silver Hammer about, you know, beating the guy in the head, you know, and death and stuff? I'm sure that everything that's wrong with the world today is a result of that White Album. I mean, there's no question in my mind.
Well, John, I agree with that to a large extent. I mean, look at the nursery rhymes that we have, you know, with the witches baking Hansel and Gretel or wanting to in the ovens and so forth. I agree with that.
A lot of people are doing that today.
Now, let's get back to
the old rhyme of Ring Around the Rosy, which illustrates that. Ring Around the Rosy, pocket full of posy, ashes, ashes, we all fall down, originated during the plague.
Okay, then let's go back to what Frank was saying before, when Frank said he didn't think there were any foul words that you could speak that would have you end up in hell. And Wendell was disagreeing with him because there were young children. Now you're saying the business about nursery rhymes. Would you now, if you're going to ban rock music, would you now ban nursery rhymes?
No. What I said, John, was that the issue over labeling of records was society feels that they have, and at least in a legal way, a more of a stake in governing what is given to minors than they do to adults. You can go down here right down the street in the porno theater and walk in, no problem, because you don't look like you're under 18. Somebody who is 13 or 12 or 8 may have problems getting in there. They won't have any problems watching
ABC. That's when people really want to go. When they're 12 and 13, they don't want to go when they're my age. Good evening. Welcome to the show. You have a question or a comment?
Yes, I do. I'm interested in finding out about this word contra. I mean, it's kind of like a generic word. I mean, what is a contra? What's their program? I mean, maybe if you had them on the show and they talked about their program along with maybe some opponents, we could get a clearer idea of what it's all about.
We've been trying to get a couple of people. Most of them are in Florida and Washington. But if it ever comes back, there was a brilliant documentary on PBS about 7 weeks ago called War on Nicaragua. It wasn't called War in Nicaragua. It was called War on Nicaragua. And they had actual footage and interviews of the businessman, I can't remember his name, who was recruited by the CIA because he gave the best image to be the channel for funds from the CIA to start up the Contras. And he did it for 2 years. He was trained and he was coached by them. Then they showed footage of him with his CIA operatives being interviewed by the American press, where they asked him, have you been coached? And he says, no. And after 2.5 years, he gave it up because they found they were killing women and children. And we've been trying to get him ever since I saw that documentary, but they're very difficult to track down. Anyway, we have to take another break because commercials aren't difficult to track down. We'll be right back with your questions and comments right after this. Welcome back. Now, I was just thinking, you were talking about the business of music and, you know, it has a negative influence. I mean, the most popular show in the country now is The Cosby Show. Do you find people running around and telling jokes? Not running around telling jokes. They're either died. And I'm sure the people watch The Cosby Show. I'm sure if you went out and did research right now, you would find out that there were people who got AIDS while watching the Cosby Show during a commercial break, or jumped out a window or committed suicide. And you could do all kind of research to say the Cosby Show is causing this.
No, John, what I think the Cosby Show shows is that America has a tremendous hunger for the values of family, of decency, of honesty, and portraying a normal form of family life. And we have one television showing after the two gays live together, two lesbians live together, some guy that has three heads lives with somebody with one head or whatever. And if people have a hunger for what they are, the average American is not like that. And they love the Cosby Show.
But is there any such thing as an average American? That's the wonderful thing about this country, is that we're not average. All of us is supposed to be distinctive.
No, we are distinctive, and this is one of the reasons when you were talking a little while ago about why did Asner get fired and why Stacey Keach has a show. We have a great diversity in this country, and that's its strength, as long as each of the groups has mutual respect one for the other. And these groups exert various influences at various places at various times. And I submit on the Stacey Keach matter that the public is far more willing to forgive a personal sin of or a personal failure than they are of a person who uses their position to engage in foreign policy.
Let's take a question. Good evening. Welcome to the show. You have a question or a comment?
Yeah, I have a comment and a question for Mr. Zappa.
Yes, go ahead.
First of all, I'd like to tell you, Mr. Zappa, that I admire your position on the blown out of proportion controversy surrounding rock and roll today. And my question is, first part, are you familiar with an artist named John Astley?
No.
Okay, well, my question surrounds lyrics of his. I'm currently listening to his newest album that he's put out on Atlantic labels. And one of the songs, I'll give you a brief lyric from it, it's called The Animal.
Okay.
And the lyric goes something like, this is my house, this is my country, this is my kingdom, come see my army, this is my army, and I am the animal. Now, I'm listening to this, and I hate to say it, but ultra-conservative family came into the room while I was listening to it and took these lyrics as being satanic. They put symbolism into it that weren't there, as I can tell by your expression.
Excuse me, let me ask you, first, your first name, and secondly, how old are you?
My name's Ned, and I'm 19.
And your family was shocked by those lyrics?
By those lyrics. They told me that they figured that he was singing that he was Satan, and this country, you know, the United States, was his country, and he's taking over it because he's Satan. They put this fictitious symbolism in the lyrics, and I was curious, how can I communicate to them that they're putting symbolism in these lyrics that are certainly not there?
Don't follow them with the evidence. Their mind is already made up.
I think your parents have a problem, and I think that that attitude is not unique. I think that there are other parents who have a similar difficulty in comprehending what rock and roll lyrics are about or the style of the imagery that's in the lyrics and are predisposed to seeing and hearing what they think lurks behind. The idea of this lurking danger of satanic whatever it is has been planted in the parents' minds by people like Tipper Gore and the rest of these ones who claim that there is a menace.
I disagree. I think the parents probably, Ed's parents are probably scared to death because the rock culture in this country, look, we have one of their famous stars right to the drop.
Hold it a second, Wendell, hold it.
Well, they may be scared to death,
but they're wrong. The thing that is scary is that Ned can't talk to his mother and father.
That is, I agree, and that was my next
comment. I mean, that's scarier than anything that you're going to say about the ogre of Satanism being in those lyrics. The fact that that young man cannot sit down with his mother and father
and has to call this show for help.
Has to
instead of writing to the Playboy.
He could have had a VA, right.
No, there's no doubt about this. You should be talking to his parents, but I think probably what leads to his parents' uptightness is the fear of what they see that revolves around this industry.
No,
wait a minute. Wait, there's one thing.
I don't want my kids hearing.
That's
I don't want my kids hearing spirituals like "Go Down, Moses." You know, they're very innocent.
You want your children to hear Jim Baker? You want your children to hear Jim Baker? Would you turn him on?
Ned, thank you so much for your call. Good luck with your mother and father, and thank you all for watching. Thank you for calling, Wendell. Thank you for being here. Paul,
always
thank you.
Pleasure.
The Realist, if you want to buy The Realist, how can we order it?
Oh, box 1230, Venice, California, $23 for 12 issues.
And how often do you print it?
Every few months.
Frank, thank you so much for being here. It's a pleasure to see you again. William, thank you so much. Thank we'll you. See you all next Friday night. Next Friday night's going to be ladies' night. We're going to have Peter Holm here as well, because every lady should have a Peter Holm. We'll see you then. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
Transportation for some of John Barber's guests provided by the Elegant Coach Company Incorporated Limousine Service.